Today I want to talk to you guys about dead in sin, dead to sin, alive in Christ. This topic has been in my heart for a long time. I think ever since July, I've had this in my head for a long time. I just really felt that we need to talk about this or discuss this. So which is why during the week, I think the last 2 weeks of the devotion that we had, it was about dead to sin and alive in Christ. Okay, so if you have done your devotion, you probably have a greater idea of what this is all about. And if you haven't, go back to it this week and really spend your own quality time with God using those devotions. Because the thing is, we're really trying to help people and trying to help you guys grow as much as you can. Right? What church is about is to be connected with each other as you are in church, as you are in house group, as you are talking to people and understanding where people are in their journey of life. We're connected and then we're growing. If you're connected, you should be growing. Like, I don't know how you measure growth, but you don't have to worry about how you grow. Now, you don't have to worry about how much you grow. All you have to worry about is that you're growing. That you are not the same person now that you were before. Like I was saying in the youth yesterday, we noticed that people in the Bible did not end their life the way they started. Right? For example, how did David start his life? As a what? As a shepherd. How did he end his life? As a king. He grew. Right? How about Peter? How did he start his life? As a fisherman. And how did he end his life? As a martyr for Jesus Christ. And we see that throughout the whole Bible. Even Jesus, he started as a what? As a student, right? He went to the synagogue as a student. He ended up living out his calling and he died for all mankind. So we see the Bible, people, how they started is not how they finish. And that's what growing is all about. We want to grow to the point where you are in your 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, and realize that you are not where you started. Imagine a little boy, imagine Zachary right now. You know, he's breastfed. Imagine at 60 years old, he's still being breastfed. That's not funny, you know. That's pretty disturbing. And I saw an article during the week how this lady wanted to breastfeed his son until 8 years old. I'm thinking, 8 years old? That's my niece Joy, right? Joy is eight, no, she's not 8 years old. Runha, 8 years old. Wow, that's pretty gross, you know? That's pretty gross. But then I'm like, okay, well, whatever makes you happy. But then I was thinking, but there needs to be some sort of growth that happens in life, right? And so that's why we do all these things. That's why I want to talk to you guys about this, because we want to see you guys grow. Okay? And then after we're connected, we're growing, and we're going to serve. We serve because we love other people, we love God, we want to use what God has given to us in our hands and make sure that people are blessed by that. Yeah? Are you guys blessed by the worship team?
Yeah.
Yeah. They spend a long time, you know, practicing, preparing, right? Are you guys blessed by the finance department that you guys don't even see?
Yes.
Because of them, we're able to get reimbursed, you know, we're able to manage the finances to the point where we can get new carpets. 17 years later, we get new carpets, right? Are you blessed by the sound people who make sure that our microphone is working, the battery is full? Yes, it is, it's full. And everything is working nicely. The bass, the treble, everything's working. Right, the lighting operator right now, we have Jason does the lighting. You guys enjoying the lighting? It's pretty nice, right? It's pretty cool, right? People are serving in the cellar, in the back, doing projector. You guys don't realize how hard it is doing projector. We're going to have a whole training to with the new software to make sure that our projector is on par. I have to write down a list of what we need to do, you know, like, because it's not easy. And there's a lot of things that people cleaning up. There's the maintenance team. Benny is in charge of the maintenance team at Infinity. You guys don't realize that, but he does that. I make sure that everything's cleaned up. So we need to connect, grow, and serve. Right? So that's why I want to talk to you guys about this, because this pretty much, hopefully, propels you to be connected, to grow, and to serve. Right? The idea of dead to sin and alive in Christ. You know, sometimes we react differently to insects. Right, some of us, who is not scared of spiders or cockroaches or things like that? Who is terrified of cockroaches, spiders? Okay, that's fine. Okay, more people are terrified, they're not. Right? I grew up with this guy who was so scared of us. Does that bother you guys? Oh, sorry. I grew up with a guy who was so terrified of insects, of a lizard, right? This guy was like the big, he's like twice my size, he was strong, he was athletic, he was smart. Yet somehow he was so petrified and terrified of insects. And so I remember one time, I can never forget this incident. We're just hanging out at church, I was sitting down here, and then I saw a lizard, right? So I picked it up, and I was like, hey, look at this, And this guy just bolted out. Like you can see the little blinds that you have, that's in the door. Before we had one on the actual main door, he bolted out to the point where he broke the blinds. Like he was literally bent and everything and broken because of this guy, because he just ran out. I was like, it's okay. And I chased after him. And it was so funny because this guy was so terrified and scared of spiders and cockroaches. And so I'm living with a woman who is terrified, right? And this blew my mind. So I'm okay, I understand people may be scared of spiders or insects, right? But then, it was a dead spider, so a small one. I'll punch you later, right? There's a dead spider, it was just very small. And it was nothing, it wasn't even moving. And I picked it up, and I was like, I said, look at this. And she got so scared. And I was like, it's okay, it's dead. No, I don't want to touch it. But it's dead, it's not going to hurt you. I understand if it's going to jump on you, it's alive, or it's going to come into your mouth and you're going to swallow it, right? But then it's dead, I see. And so she was scared. Even to the point where one time I just got home and I said, oh, can you pick it up? I'm like, what? It was a dead cockroach on the floor. I'm like, it's okay, it's dead, just pick it up. He goes, no, you pick it up. And I'm like, look at Maddie and Judah, they scared me because of you. And so I didn't teach Judah, pick it up, Judah, you pick it up, right? So it's okay, like if you're scared of a live one, but sometimes we can be scared of dead insects, right? I don't know, you guys scared of dead insects as well?
Yes.
Like spiders? Okay, alright, so it's not just asking. And so, to me, it's very, very funny. It's very, very funny, right? Oh, sorry. That's a very, very funny picture. And then, but the thing is, sometimes we can play like that with how sin is, right? I love this passage in Romans 6, verse 1 to 2. This is what it says. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means, we are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Sometimes we can entertain things that are not alive. Sin has been conquered. Amen? Death has been conquered. Amen? There was victory over death in Jesus Christ. But yet sometimes we can feel defeated with sin. Sometimes we can flirt with it. Sometimes we think and entertain that sin is alive. But on the flip side, we can get bothered so much by it. As a guy, I know what it means to be bothered by sin. Right? It's crazy. And I remember growing up, and I hear people say this line to me all the time. They say, Chris, if God forgives, why do we need to ask for forgiveness all the time? If God has forgiven our sins on the cross, why do we need to ask for forgiveness all the time? Have you guys ever asked that question? I've asked that question. Like, I know you've already forgiven my sin. Then why should I ask for forgiveness again, God? The thing is, people who ask these kind of questions is asking the right thing. It's true. Why do we have to do it? But they're asking it with the wrong motive. They're asking it with the wrong attitude. When people ask this question, even when I ask this myself, I wanted to commit sin without feeling any guilt. That's what it was. Why do I have to ask forgiveness? Can't I just do it and not worry about it? But then I remember what Paul says in this passage, Romans 6, 1 to 2. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning by that so that grace may increase? Paul is asking this question rightfully because people are asking this question. Can we go on sinning? If God's grace is so strong, we should be able to sin so God's grace may increase. God's grace and God's love may be more evident in our life. So we should just do it anyway. Don't worry about it. And then he continues and says, by no means. We are those who have died to sin. So how can we live in it any longer?
Yeah.
And that's the big question there. How can we live in it any longer? If you know what sin is, you will avoid it as best as you can. You know it wouldn't be nice, it's not fun, it's not enjoyable. It becomes a burden. If you know what sin is, you will try as much as you can to avoid it. Or try to understand what this is all about. So sin is one of those things that we don't talk about often. But I want to talk about it today, okay? Dead to sin, alive in Christ. Right? So what is sin? What is sin? Sin in the Greek word means hamartano. Everyone say hamartano. It means to miss the mark. To miss the mark in the relationship that we have with God. It damages our relationship between mankind and God. That's what sin is. It damages your relationship with God. It's not about what you do that makes God angry. That's not what sin is. It's what you do that causes your relationship to be far and distant. That's what sin is. I'm going to elaborate this even deeper, okay? But I need you guys to tell me what you guys want. Do you want me to give you an exegesis of Romans 6, 1 to 14? There's about 24 pages of this. And when you read it, you're going to understand this so much.
Yes.
You guys
want to? Yes, amen.
You guys want an exegesis of sin? Oh, let's do an illustration instead. Let me summarize this in an illustration. Sin is missing the mark. I have here a bullseye. Alright? It's a bullseye, sorry. Nate destroyed my. It said the law. It says law, okay?
That's racist.
Alright? Here you go. Okay, it works. Shoot when I tell you to shoot.
No.
If you run out of clips. It's William Wells. So the sin is the outer circle. Okay? So this is sin. Alright? This represents sin. The bullets represent your actions. Okay? So your actions are the bullets. And the law is the target. That's the bullseye. We have to aim for a great relationship with God. Your actions is what causes your relationship with God to either be closer or more distant. So sometimes we want to make sure that we aim for the law.
Yeah,
we aim to do the right thing, right? By praying, by reading the Bible, by doing good, by living out our calling, by applying what we've heard, by listening to others, by loving others. These are the actions that we do in order to draw near to God or to have that relationship with God even stronger. For example, if I don't do anything with Nico as my cousin-in-law, right? I don't do anything with him. How is our relationship? Nothing, non-existent, right? Like, in that, I just met her 2 weeks ago, right? I haven't really talked to her properly, so I don't really know her. Right? But I know Nico. But if I want to get to know her, I need to do things with her. Right? I need to talk to her, I need to ask her questions, I need to hang out with her, I need to find out about her past life, you know, just what she likes, right? I need to get to know that person. So there are actions that you require in order to get closer to God, in order to be alive with Christ. So what we have here is an action that is trying to have a relationship with God. Okay? So, start shooting every like 2-3 seconds. Okay? Okay? Alright. If I were to ask you, what relationship did people have with God prior to Genesis 1? What would you say? Yeah, it's okay, keep going. You aim for that, okay? So in Genesis 1, before Genesis 1, right, Adam and Eve had a great relationship with God. Okay? But yet, they fell into sin. Right? It looks right out of it. We feel it. Okay? They had a great relationship, but things happened and didn't work out. Okay? Things happened and didn't work out because they committed a sin. Because of that sin, they were distant. They were far from God. They got banished from the Garden of Eden. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay? Yeah. And on, we see that in Isaiah 14, 12 to 14, it talks about Lucifer. Keep shooting, guys. Lucifer, in Isaiah 14, 12, and verse 14, we see that Lucifer was close with God. He was worshiping. He was in the company of Him. But yet something happens. He committed a sin, and then he was distant from Him. Does that make sense? Are you not getting it?
Oh!
And sometimes, for us as people, we can live our lives trying to do the right thing, right? We want to try to do the right thing. But most of the time, we miss the mark. Just like Timothy, he keeps on going this way, going that way, right? He missed the mark. And sometimes in our life, as people, we try to get close with God, right? You have a relationship with God. We try to have a relationship with God. We try to read our Bible. We try to pray. And sometimes it's a lot harder than it looks. Is that right? It's a lot harder than it looks. And sometimes we get tempted and we get thrown into pornography. Sometimes we get tempted. We don't want to get into pornography. But somehow, we just end up doing it. We end up watching something. Sometimes we get very judgmental over people, right? We don't want to. We want to love others. That's what we say to ourselves. We want to love others. But yeah, we can be very, very judgmental. Oh, man, that person's wearing. Oh, that's so embarrassing. Can't believe he said that. Oh, you know, did you see what he did? Did you see what she said? Did you see? Like, all this judgment, gossip happens, even though you don't want to sometimes. But yeah, it just happens. You miss the mark, right? You miss the mark. Sometimes you try to do something, you miss the mark. But from time to time, maybe once in a while, you spend time with God, you understand, you get a revelation, and you help people, and you see things as it is, you know? You get excited, you get passionate, you grow, and you hear from God. And then, another time, you get angry. Angry is okay, but then when it comes to hating someone, then we've already missed the mark. We committed a sin. We missed the mark. Because we got angry with someone. We don't want to get angry, but someone just can't help it. I'm so annoyed with that person, you know? I hate that person. I wish that person could go to hell, you know? Someone said that to me one time. You should go to hell. I'm like, excuse me? I'm going to heaven, alright? Someone said that to me a long time ago. And so sometimes we can get close with God, and other times we can miss the mark. Right? Sometimes we enjoy God's presence, and sometimes we hate people. We hate people, and we can't help it sometimes, but we just miss the mark, right? And then we lie. We lie. We say lies to people. Like we exaggerate. You know, we underplay something. We stole something. We lie. We lie to our parents. This is our relationship with God sometimes. Can you guys relate? Mm-hmm. This is our relationship with God sometimes. And sometimes we have a great encounter with God. We learn something, and then we worship, we encounter God, we want to do a revelation, we're changing, we're growing, we read the whole of the book of John, we listen to this, we listen to that, we're growing, we're being fed so much, right? And during those times, we feel like we did the right thing, you know? We did what the Word of God tells us, and we did it right, and our relationship with God is stronger, it's closer. And yet, there are other times we get jealous, we covet, we want what other people have. We see that nice car, that person driving, oh man, my car's such a bomb. I'm gonna save up, I'm gonna not go to church, I'm gonna work 7 days a week so that I can buy that car, you know? And then we have jealousy in our heart. We have covetous. And we want what other people have. That's not what God wants. That destroys your relationship with God. That distance yourself from God. Because that's not what God is all about. Right? And then there's pride. Pride of not wanting to ask for forgiveness or saying sorry, or pride in I don't know what pride does, like just not willing to learn, like not being teachable, right? And One time you're so loving God, learning so much, and other times you just don't care about it anymore. Just don't care about it anymore. And you miss the mark. Okay, you can stop. Oh, you've already stopped. Right? So we may seem to miss the mark more times than getting things right. Is that right? As you can see from these guys' aim and shooting ability, they have missed the mark completely. Right? Not completely. I think there's like one or two there. Right? And the thing is, when we miss that mark, you may think that you have hit a roadblock. You may feel like you've hit a roadblock. And you just feel like, oh, I can't believe this is happening again. I can't believe that, oh man, I can't believe I fell again. Oh, I can't believe I watched that thing again. I can't believe I started to hate and be angry again. And we feel that way because we've just missed the mark. Because your view is from this position. Because we see things with the Lord as a bullseye. We see things with the Lord as our target, trying to do the right thing. Which is not wrong, we need to do it. But we see it as a massive, massive homework. If we don't do it, we're stuffing up. Because it happens, right? It happens to me. Like, I miss the mark here and there. But your view and our view as human beings is that we see things from this perspective. But I've got good news for you guys. We live in a new covenant. We live under a new covenant. We live under a new promise. And that promise is what God cherishes. Within that promise, God cherished every moment that we have. God promised everything that you went, that goes in, He cherished it. He holds on to it. He carries it everywhere with Him. I can't carry it. He carries it everywhere with Him. Because He cherished those moments that He has with you. Don't think that it was for nothing. Don't think that that time that you're worshipping God was for nothing. Because He's carrying it. He's like, oh, I remember that time with Chris, you know, when he was there, you know, like worshipping and reading that Bible in the prayer tower and just staying there for 6 hours and falling asleep. You know, I cherish those moments. You know, I cherish those moments. Right? God's holding on to that because of the new covenant. Because He doesn't see it from our point of view. He doesn't see it from our point of view. In Hebrews 6, this is the time that you guys do it. That's what you guys want to do, right? Come here, guys. He doesn't see it from our point of view. In Hebrews 6, verse 10, He says, God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown Him, as you have helped these people and continue to help them. And the thing is, one thing that we don't sometimes understand is that we need to see things from His perspective. We need to see things from how He sees it. When we see that we've missed the mark, when we see that we've committed to sin, sometimes we can take it seriously. Sometimes things that are dead, things that are not alive anymore, things that are not really there, but because of the whisper of the enemy, we entertain it, just like a dead cockroach. It's dead, man. You can eat it and it's fine, right? No, you can't, right? Actually, it's pretty healthy. Apparently, you can eat cockroaches and it's very good protein or something. But the thing is, a dead cockroach cannot fly in your mouth. In Jesus' perspective, the thing is, the ones that you miss are considered sin by the Lord. The ones you miss, everything here, these are sin. By law, it's a sin to commit this. Your action of jealousy was a sin. The moment you missed that mark, it was a sin. But the thing is, because of your new covenant, what He does is He picks it up and He puts it in. Right? He picks up your jealousy and He puts it in. He picks up your anger and He puts it in. He picks it up and He puts it in. Your covenants, you want something what others have. You know you shouldn't have done that because you missed the mark. He picks it up and He puts it in. You were looking at pornography. You know you shouldn't have done that. You know you shouldn't have masturbated. You know you shouldn't have lust over those people, or that person, or that celebrity, or that picture, or that video. He picks it up and he puts it in. He knows that you're not happy when someone has what you don't have. He picks it up and he puts it in. He knows sometimes we can be jealous of other people. He picks it up and puts it in. Sometimes we can feel lazy. And what he does, he picks it up and puts it in. Sometimes there's a judgmental thought that you have which you can't help, but it happens. You gossip and you talk about something bad about someone without you even realizing. You made a judgment call. He picks it up and he puts it in. He picks up your mistakes. He picks it up and puts it in. Like you haven't grown. And you know once upon a time, you were close with God. And you're very hungry of Him. You miss that feeling of being close with Him. And somehow you just can't get back. He picks up that feeling up. He puts it in. And on and on. And what does He do with it? Because of that cross, He carries it with Him. He cherished every single moment that He has. Even though you made a mistake, you know you don't want that. He carries it with Him. Even though you, once upon a time, you did the right thing all the time, you're close, and you're always serving, always reading the Bible, and yet you fell behind, you got tempted. You know you shouldn't have done that. You've repented. He picks it up, puts it in, and carries it. That's why there are times when people used to leave God and then they would come back to church and feel like and say things like, yeah, I just feel like something's missing in my life. Why? It's because God is carrying that for them. The sin is not scattered all over the ground for people to trample on. It's not for you to feel bad about. It's for you to understand, okay, you've done it, you know you shouldn't have done it, you know you shouldn't have entertained the thing that is dead. Because Jesus has carried it already. It's with Him. Right? He carries it everywhere we go. That's why in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, what does it say? Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In Ephesians 2 verse 8, it says, for it is by grace you have been saved. It is by grace that Jesus is picking up the pieces on the floor and puts it in. It is by grace, through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Sometimes we can entertain sin to the point where we either really, really live it out or allow it to annoy us or allow it to disrupt our relationship with God. But the thing is, your sins are not what you think it is. It's not scattered all over the place from the viewpoint of law or to meaning to do things, but it is from the view of Jesus Christ. Jesus, everything's clean. That's why you are therefore alive in Christ. Amen. Don't feel burdened by the mess that you've made. Don't feel burdened and don't entertain yourself by the sins that has been scattered all over the ground. Don't entertain yourself as a dead cockroach that can't really touch you anymore, that cannot fly towards your face anymore. Don't entertain the fact that it's still alive. Don't entertain the fact that those things are bothering Jesus. So back to what Paul said in the beginning. So what shall we do then? That we are dead to sin and alive in Christ. In other words, don't let the dead sin or the death of Christ be for nothing. Now, the biggest insult that you can ever give Jesus is that He already died for you on the cross, but somehow you live as if you were the one on the cross. That is the biggest insult. biggest insult is that he already took everything. When you repent, when you give your life to Christ, he took everything. Yes, you're not perfect. Yes, sometimes you miss the mark. But yet we live in a state, not from this point of view, but from the other point of view. That's a big insult to Jesus. Imagine that. Imagine someone died for you. Someone stepped in front of the bus for you. He had pushed you away, they stepped in front of the bus for you. And you spent your whole entire life saying, oh, I was a bad person. I can't believe I did this. I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I shouldn't have been there. I shouldn't have been there. What a great insult. You've just wasted a life by saying things like that. But instead of saying, someone died for me, I should do greater things because of them. They gave me a second chance. They gave me an opportunity. They gave me an ability to come out from my despair. That's how Jesus thinks. This is what dead to sin and alive in Christ is all about. And I love this passage, Romans 6, 11, verse 14. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. In other words, do not let these things, right, instead of it being there, it's all over your body, it's all over your head, you know, like, it's all over your, it's weighing you down, right? Do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Yes, I can't believe I did that. Yes, I know I'm wrong, I'm stupid, I'm dumb, you know. So that you obey sin. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness. Right? Do not offer yourself to it. Take it, give it back here. Give it back, that's what Jesus said. Give it back. Right? Do not use this. Do not offer yourself to this. Do not hold on to this, right, as an instrument of wickedness. But rather, offer yourself to God. Offer it. Offer it to God. Offer it to God. Offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And offer every part of yourself to Him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. Amen? So the thing is, if those things are all over the floor, if our mindset, if your heart sees it from the other perspective, when all of these things are on the floor, it's going to be very, very hard for you to continue to do it. Because what you're thinking is like, what's the point? What's the point? I'm just going to miss the mark anyway. But if you are alive in Christ, if you understand that you are dead to sin, that these things are not here anymore, but Jesus has carried it, and you still will commit sin, but the thing is, how can we get to a position where we can not miss as much, where we don't live with this junk in our life? And what you need to do is that when you shoot, when you try to act, you need to draw closer and closer to God as you start shooting. Don't miss. But it's okay. It's very hard to miss when you're close to God. Amen. Sometimes you miss, right? Sometimes you stumble. But most of the time,
thank you.
But most of the time, the more you are close to God, the more you draw near to Him, the more He draws near to you. As James 4:8 says, draw near to God and He shall draw near to you. Those things in the floor, that's not matter anymore, because you know it's not in the way. And as you try to live your life to do the right thing, sometimes it falls. But when it goes in, it's not because you're good, it's simply because you're just closer to God.